Had to do that better than the Rangers and their fans. In 79, it was Montreal that took the cup away. 7 years before that, many believe Jean Ratel was the key to the Stanley Cup, or rather his broken ankle was the key to losing it to the Boston Bruins, who forced cringing Ranger fans to watch them with the cup in their garden. The other bad break for the Rangers was the springtime contract the building had with the circus. Too valuable to break, forcing the Rangers in 1950 to play only on the road, losing to Detroit in the only Cup final to be decided in a seventh game double overtime, when they twice led by 2 goals. In 1940, Brian Hextall's goal beat Toronto. They had a small party at a hotel, and later garden management burned mortgage papers in the Cup itself. 54 years of waiting said maybe that was a bad idea.
Those past years, John, there was so many expectations, so many hopes and dreams, and they were all shattered, but this year, it came together. The Rangers finally went all the way, and when you look around and you see Stanley Cup championship hat and t-shirt, you realize it actually happened.
And you really think about it, the previous season, the Rangers never even made the playoffs, so who knew what to expect? Training camp comes along, the team goes over to London, England, and beats Toronto in a 2-game series, and gee, they look good, and you could sense there was some chemistry there. And then as the season moved along, there's always ups and there's downs. The chemistry of this team and its willingness to look at adversity and not shy away from it, I think, got them through the season as a great hockey club.
And it seemed during the season and in the playoffs, whenever something bad happened, they handled it pretty well.
Well, again, there was no fear of adversity. And I guess you look at leadership and people like Mark Messier and Kevin Lowe, then you see the core of young stars on this team like Brian Leetch and others. You can sense that, gee, there was something special. This team was going to go forward. There was no fear at all with this hockey club.
In 1940, the Rangers won with a new coach. In 94, they had another in Mike Keenan. And one of the first things he demanded was a state-of-the-art level of fitness.
By far the best. That's record.
It's on five.
Four. Come on now.
Not a bit.
Well, here we are in Glens Falls after one day, and conditioning coach Howie Wenger has been doing a great job with our stretching. As you can tell, before we started, we were a little tight, but now, after one day, as you can see, Howie's done a great job.
This team was also asked to imagine.
I want to know the parade route simply because of the excitement that can be generated in New York City. I heard so much about it myself, about the various parades that they've had here, and I want the players to be able to visualize themselves at some point enjoying that opportunity and enjoying that success here in New York. And if you can't see it, you'll never achieve it. So we have to start right from the very beginning and building the blocks that are necessary to take the walk along the block.
Much to give you this love in my heart that I'm feeling for you. Let them say we're crazy. What do they know? Put your arms around me, baby. Don't ever let go. Let the world around us just fall apart. Baby, we
There was irony in the Rangers' first two exhibition games because they were played in London. Irony in that Lord Stanley knew this town well. And irony in that the players visited a planet built on great scripts, and they were about to write a beauty. And so it began, versus the team that New York beat in 1940. Another irony. It went well.
With confidence, boys. Play with authority and go with confidence.
On the tape, boys. Everything on the tape.
By Damian Rhodes, Gartner has it back. Kovalov. Score! Brian Leetch off a brilliant feed from Alexei Kovalov.
The Rangers of 94 had won their first trophy together and were obviously ready for the long 84-game regular season. Then again, maybe not. In their 7th October game, they play a team named the Mighty Ducks and are forced to remember a similar meeting with Tampa Bay a year before when they were embarrassed by an expansion team at home. This time, the sub-500 Blue Shirts are victimized by a team playing Disney hockey. It was tough to take, especially for a coach who was focused on the Stanley Cup, answering questions centered around what was missing. But with strong direction, they changed things. In fact, in October's final week, the Rangers begin a 22-game stretch where they lose only once and move into first place, where they would be for the rest of the season. But there was change. Team favorites Darren Turcotte and James Patrick were traded in a three-team deal that brought Chicago's unbreakable star Steve Larmer to New York. He knows the meaning of the term work, played for Keenan before, and scored in his first Ranger game.
Larmer trying to get into position, Amonte holding, looking, Keenan battling in front against Dittick. Amonte still waiting, finds Lowe, gets it back, wrap around in front, they score!
Oh, baby.
Steve Larmer gets his first goal as a New York Ranger.
That was a rather mellow, oh, baby, but things take time. There were others when defenseman Jeff Bukaboom ended his holdout. In fact, the coach, the players, the focus, the dream was starting to take shape.
Kovalov finding the open man, score! Here's Adam Graves breaking in, shorthanded. Adam Graves scores! Here goes Tikkanen, two on one with Larmer, back is Bergevin. Tikkanen is there for Larmer, he scores!
Esa Tikkanen, one of the many ex-Oilers whose reputation was built in Edmonton and on the Stanley Cup. His resume says defensive pest, scores big goals, and keeps the team loose. He can at times be a bit loony, and there's opportunity for that in this town. Stopping the puck. The mission for the Rangers was finding the one that they would lean on. There was Mike Richter, and there was Glenn Healy, who had been heroic one season earlier with the dreaded Islanders. But if fans thought it was a battle for supremacy, they didn't.
We're not the key focal point of the Rangers as to who's going to be the starting goalie, who's going to be the backup goalie. We're just one of 20 players whose goal is to win. One, to make the playoffs, two, to win the Stanley Cup.
If nobody is here and you had the number one spot handed to you, if you don't play well with that, they're going to get somebody else. They're going to trade you. So you have to answer to yourself, play as well as you can, and leave it at that.
Shot from the point, saved by Richter. Schneider shot, a rebound, a save by Richter, and another one. Here comes Peter White breaking in. White down the middle. White on Richter, and a save made. The rebound, another save. Richter kicked it out.
In Mike Keenan's unspoken plan, Richter was getting most of the work, but the plan also included other reminders of teamwork and sacrifice, like skipping practice in Washington to visit the Vietnam Veterans Memorial, which generated thoughts of extreme sacrifice, took the team away from it all, and reminded them of having an overall goal, or stopping a few.
Johansson winds up, stopped by Richter. Skates with it, plays it around. He's got a shutout. The Rangers and Mike Richter shut out the Caps 2-0. Leetch plays the puck again. Intercepted. McGillie shoots and it's blocked. McGillie again. The save by Richter.
Oh, baby. A distinct difference in the confidence and the way Mike Richter is playing the game. Look at his eyes. Look at the focus.
When you play game in, game out, it gives you the opportunity to just really feel comfortable in net. You're in a groove. You're ready to go.
By the 19th day of December, Mike Richter was clearly the number one goaltender. He was about to set a little history. The victim was Ottawa.
And a franchise record, 20 games without a loss for Mike Richter.
Eerily, he broke the record of Dave Kerr, set in 1940 when the Rangers won the, you know. Christmas time, and the Rangers have a lot to celebrate, including the gifts of Mike Gartner, as he combines skill and longevity in the countdown to 600 goals.
Back pass, nobody there, and Gino fires for Gartner. The defenseman fell down, Gartner is in, he scores! The 598th career goal for Mike Gartner. Messier, Gartner, and Graves. Gartner scores! Number 599!
I would envision it as getting the puck behind our own net and stick handling through five guys and then putting the puck between my up over the goalie's shoulder. That's how I would envision it, but I'm sure it's probably going to be a tip-in off the side of my stick or a rebound goal or something like that.
2-on-1 developing. Kovalov looking for Gartner. Score!
Yes! Yes!
Number 600 for Mike Gartner! Take the stick, take the puck, take Mike Gartner and send him right to the Hall of Fame.
Chicago, Chicago.
For Mike Keenan, a January return to the Windy City meant talking about Chicago, a fractured personal life Chicago, and bitter Blackhawk memories. For Steve Larmer, it meant coming back to what was home for so long and doing so with a fractured finger that would keep an average player out 3 weeks. So much for being average.
I've been fortunate throughout my whole career not to have any major setbacks, and I think the frustrating thing about this is it's been a finger and, you know, my legs and everything else still works, so we're gonna try and get through it and play through it.
18,472 on their feet at Chicago Stadium. Larmer goes towards Belfour. He scores!
Oh, baby!
A great moment, another Ranger win. On the third weekend of 1994, the league's best players came to Madison Square Garden for the first time in 20 years. The team had four representatives, Brian Leach, Richter, Mark Messier, and Adam Graves. The mayor, Rudolph Giuliani, a very big fan, was there, and so was honorary captain and Ranger Hall of Famer, Rod Gilbert. The star of stars was Mike Richter, who made the big saves, starred in the headlines, and drove away in a new truck. You would have to think long and hard to find an athlete who played under more pressure than Mark Messier. Pressure and pain. That had become a source of concern and speculation. So much so, questions of wrist surgery arose, and with those questions, doubts about Stanley Cup dreams.
They've assured me that it's not going to be a nagging injury, and I think that we can rest easy with that.
By February, the team's confidence was growing, and so was the depth of the snow. It got so bad that on the night of February 11th, when the Garden was supposed to be filled with cheers for their first-place team, the Rangers game versus Quebec would not be seen, and MSG first. Alexei Kovalov will remember this as a time when there was a cold war between him and his coach. The Rangers' future star wasn't scoring and became frustrated. And frustrated hockey players often use their stick. And hockey players who often use their stick are suspended. And suspended hockey players get a reputation and maybe more time off. Mike Keenan didn't like that at all.
The behavior that we've seen out of him lately, there's no excuse for it, and all I can do is ask him to change and verbalize it for him. I can't control his conduct on the ice, and if he continues to hurt us, then it would probably behoove Neil to trade him.
No more suspension because it's not good for me. Next suspension, I will play a different team.
That didn't happen, but what did was obvious after Kovalov wore the dunce cap and grew up as a result. In the final 29 games of the season, he scored 15 times, and the Garden buzzed every time he touched the puck.
Kovalov gets to the puck and moves in, he scores!
Great pass out by Kovalov to Larmer, and Racine got across.
That shot score, Alexei Kovalov! With 36.7 seconds to go, Kovalov does it again!
The Cold War was over, and he had a warm feeling again. New York has a little something for everyone, and in Brooklyn, the Ranger Russians can find out that there's more than borscht in this melting pot. Ah, but the transition to Moscow on the Hudson isn't always easy. Sergei Zubov would say da to that. because after much early season inactivity and a trip to the minors, he emerged to lead the team in scoring.
Larmer, Graves, Messier, Graves the back pass to Zubov. He shoots, score! Sergei Zubov!
Very courageous third period by a gutsy hockey team, the Rangers. The Black Aces had become a commonly known name for a group of players who defined Ranger team depth, support, and commitment. As a group, they saw little playing time, so they focused on making practices fun and challenging, based on the belief they'd be needed and would be ready when the time came. Game time, and when one of them got a chance to come down from the rooftop, he remembered his roots.
Gartner moves in, drop to Messier. Nice pass, in, score! Peter Anderson! That's for the Black Aces!
Oh, baby!
Yeah, look at that!
Oh, do you believe it?
Gartner will drop the puck back on the fake shot to Messier. Everybody moves to that side. Anderson's wide open. And does he take his time? Completely undresses the set. Now watch him stop and look up. Oh, there's the point. Oh, that's hockey.
In March, team president Neil Smith made the last moves to prepare for the run at the Cup. That meant saying goodbye to some of the Aces and two very popular players, for others named Matteau, Noonan, Anderson, and McTavish. The opinion of the deadline moves was that the Rangers were gambling, yet going for it, with more of those who knew how to win, or others who had come close before.
I think that certainly when you think you're on the verge of something, you make a few key moves, and players may only have a little while left. Hopefully they'll have more time left, but if they only play this season and they contribute to us doing well in the playoffs, it'll be worth it.
The contribution came in the very first game following the deals. It happened in Calgary, and for ex-Blackhawk Stefan Matteau.
Tinkinen shoots in front. Matteau, he scores! Stefan Matteau, his first as a New York Ranger with 13.9 seconds remaining. Wow!
Do you
unbelievable!
Believe it?
In hockey, 50 goals determines a great scorer. Life demands a little bit more than that. King Clancy Award winner Adam Graves gives his all to both. He spent as much time with the disenfranchised as he did chasing one of the franchise's great records, held by Vic Hatfield, the only previous 50-goal scorer in the history of the team.
Lead to Messier from Anderson with Graves. Pass to Graves. There's number 50, Adam Graves. Karpovtsev there to play it toward the net, blocked in front. Graves turns. He scores! 51 goals for Adam Graves, a Rangers record.
Back home, Adam meets Vic and calls him Mr. Hatfield. The regular season's final twist came in April when the Rangers clinched the President's Trophy against Mike Gartner and Toronto.
Kept in by Todd Gill. Toward the net, Gilmore with a chance, and it slid off his stick. It might have been poked away by Richter. That shot by Gartner is a save. The rebound, another save. It's a showtime for Mike Richter. And here comes Kovalov, two on one. Kovalov scores!
One mission down, one war to go. Tabloid headlines scream out Battle of New York. Rangers versus Islanders. Bitter because of geography, history, and the city versus the suburb. 32 years old as a rivalry and being passed down by the generation. Matteau and Turgeon, lifelong friends who go back to the 82 Little League World Series playing for Canada. Then, united towards a common goal, now divided because of something called the Cup. What eventually happened in Game 1 at Madison Square Garden was so easy for the Rangers, and Brian Leetch was a big reason it looked that way. Steve Larmer followed Alexei Kovalov's shot later, and it was all part of a Rangers punch to the Islanders' belly. A 6-0 final and a 1-0 best-of-seven lead. For Game 2, Isle coach Al Arbor replaced Ron Hextall with Jamie McLennan. But even a great coach couldn't prevent history from repeating itself. You know, that deja vu thing.
The Rangers off the bench to congratulate Mike Richter. Two consecutive shutouts. Sports Radio 66.
In every single phase of the game, you see, as an Islander fan, it's hard for you to admit that the New York Rangers are better than your Islander team. There used to be a strong rivalry, but no more.
From the fan to the fans at the Nassau Coliseum, where the appropriate chanting is renewed.
Never change, never, never.
Oh, back to Delgado. Save Richter, the rebound. Saved by Leach. Ferraro breaks in. Saved by Richter. He did it again. Ferraro turns, he shoots. Save Richter, rebound. Save Richter. And a block by Kevin Lowe and the crease. The Rangers are unbelievable here. Now Malakoff, he shoots. Tipped. Save Richter without a stick.
Another lopsided win put the Rangers up 3-0, and brooms in the hands of their fans.
Maybe we get the broom ready. Did anybody say sweep? Did somebody say that Roy Orbison, It's Over, is my favorite song?
The Isles last gasp in Game 4 put them up 2-0. However, this too was lopsided after that, as Mark Messier broke some suburban hearts and a 2-2 tie in the third period. It was a 4-0 sweep when it was over, and while it exasperated a soon-to-step-down Al Arbor, it showed the Rangers as very focused and very good. The playoffs were only 4 games old, but Brian Leetch's 8 points already had created Bobby Orr-like whispers. Because of hard work, he was finally able to put a history of injury behind him and look ahead to the possibilities.
Happy to be back. I've played every game for 3 out of the last 4 years, so that, you know, the injuries I had were kind of freak things, and I wasn't worried about them happening again. But it's still no fun to be playing and not winning. It's better to go through that with your teammates, but to go through it like we did this year and to have everyone come together and to be successful, I don't even think about last year. It just seems like a distant memory.
In the playoffs, travel kills a dream or two. In the second round versus Washington, that part was easy again. As for the first time in a long time, the Rangers were still playing as the circus was wrapping up, the same circus that for years made the team playoff vagabonds. In Game 1 at the Garden, Brian Leetch's star got brighter when he broke a 2-2 tie in the second period. Something else was happening too. The team's moves made on the day of the trading deadline looked solid. This time it was Bostonian Brian Noonan scoring twice. Rangers 6, Capitals 3. In the Amtrak Series second game, things were tight until Adam Graves made it 4-2. And Stefan Matteau made it better in 19 seconds of a physical 60-minute game.
Rangers have a 4-2 lead, and Matteau scores! Off a brilliant pass from Alexei Kovalov! Oh, man! It is 5-2! By the Rangers in a span of 19 seconds.
The scene switched to a city based on great leadership, and to this point in the Ranger postseason, there was a lot of that from Brian Leetch. At this point, he was the statesman for a group on a roll. The Rangers were great again at both ends of the ice, always remembering as well not to be suckered in. The Caps took Game 4, but back in New York, Anthony Mason of the Knicks rallied the fans, and Brian Leetch did the rest.
Leetch to Graves, he scores!
But 27 seconds into the third period, Sylvain Côté tied the game, and it stayed that way until 3 minutes were left.
Zubov finds Leetch! Leetch is in! He scores! Oh, baby!
That when talent has a chance to shine and it works hard, it can provide the difference. And Brian Leetch was spectacular in this game.
What can you say about Leetch? He's just an incredible performance individually, just one of the best playoff performances I've ever seen.
He'll have his name with the greats in history.
The next round meant more easy travel, sort of. It was one for Port Authority and the agents, the Rangers versus the New Jersey Devils. Number one in the NHL versus number two. New York had shocked New Jersey by claiming all 6 regular season meetings, but it was doubtful that meant much in late spring.
I don't even remember those games, obviously, and right now,
we're playing better hockey, and we have to play with confidence. Obviously, we have to be aware of certain people out there, but it's a whole new time of the year.
To get to this point, a 22-year-old goaltender named Martin Brodeur had, in hockey parlance, stood on his head to get his team to the conference finals. At the Garden, Ranger fans talked of burying Jersey with the Caps and Islanders, and Steve Larmer tried to grab a shovel and help them out. The goal gave the Rangers a 3-2 lead, which they held until the final frantic minute.
The Devil's net is empty. McLean in deep, fires towards Lemieux's block. A save by Richter. It goes over the top. McLean against Leach. Centers. Scramble is on. Save Richter. Rebound. Score. The Devils tie it. Oh, man.
In overtime, Martin Brodeur was a major New York problem. Chances to score remained only that. Even the post was on his side. And then
Carpenter clears it out. Riche with Graves back. Riche moves in, scores!
Exactly right, you called it. Graves was back, and the Devils have gained home ice.
Undaunted, Ranger fans returned to Midtown, except for one. Seal Seidel, a fan since 1940, had been murdered the night she should have seen her beloved Rangers beat the Caps. The pace of the Rangers in Game 2 was angry, in terms of hitting. And it was all designed to get past Martin Brodeur. Eventually, Mark Messier made the strategy work. And Mike Richter tried to make it stick.
Bill Guerin with Leach back. Guerin goes around and to the net. Saved by Richter. Oh, man, what a save.
In the third, Ranger traffic had Brodeur gridlocked again. And Sergei Nemchinov took full advantage of an open lane. The Ranger win even the series, leaving the Devils slightly stunned, victimized perhaps by a lucky troll.
Two nights ago, we really didn't have as much intensity as we did tonight. I thought their goalie was playing very well, but we kept plugging, and the floodgates finally opened to our credit.
Game 3, the Meadowlands Arena, and some villains were making news. That night, Bernie Nichols viciously cross-checked Alexei Kovalov. Anger was growing, but so was the last-second tension of the series. This was the second overtime.
Kovalev in deep, shoots, and Brodeur's got it. The rebound in front, Mato scores! That's a winner! That is a winner for Stefan Mato! And the New York Rangers in double overtime! And the Rangers win it 3-2.
The Rangers led, but scowled on the bruises left behind.
He had deliberately tried to injure Alex Kovalev, when Alex was defenseless on his hands and knees, he delivered a very serious cross-check to his neck. And I hope that Mr. Bettman and Mr. Burke review it and suspend him.
In Game 4, Bernie Nichols was suspended, but the Devils rallied behind Bill Guerin. It turned out to be the bleakest moment of the Rangers under Mike Keenan, as he replaced Mike Richter with Glenn Healy, and sat Brian Leetch and Mark Messier for long stretches of the game. The Devils were even, but the Rangers were down, as Keenan cited injuries for the moves he made. Was it first aid, or was it damage control? At practice the next day, the players in question looked fine, and said so with humor in the face of team grumbling.
Well, we were thinking about bringing the MASH unit in this morning there and see if there's anybody that could replace us for tonight's game, but you know, all speculation, not true.
Oh yeah, I'll be out there. I don't have serious injuries.
I just think it's a lot of talk over nothing, really.
On the night of Game 5, the huge tribe of media members had a lot to chew on, especially since the official game note cited no injuries to report. In the game, as if to confirm a problem, the Rangers looked flat and beatable. And in the end, they were, suddenly facing elimination, and doing so without Jeff Bukaboo, who would be suspended for this hit on Stefan Richer. Then, Mark Messier said the magic word.
And I'm guaranteeing everybody here, next year we're going to win it again.
We will win the ball game. And you can put it in 3-inch headlines. We will win the ball game.
So enjoy yourself and be among those who dare to dare.
In the mold of the bold who came before him, the captain of the New York Rangers said, "We will win tonight." But for all the talk, his team in New Jersey looked distracted again and absorbed quite a beating and trailed 2-0. The Rangers' dream season appeared to be a bus on the road to summer. Then, still being badly outplayed in the second period, they called a timeout. No words were spoken, but when he stood up, he in effect said, "I'm driving this game now."
Messier backhands, he scores! Messier has tied it in two!
Kovalev's got it. Cross ice leash. Moving to the New Jersey line. Drops it for Kovalev. Left circle. Slap shot. Save. Rebound. Score! Messier!
Off the draw. Mitchell winds it around. Not out. Messier gets it back. Shoots it all the way down. And scores! Messier hits the open net. That's the hat trick for Captain Mark Messier.
People who do that, like Muhammad Ali, they're winners, and you can't say enough. There can be books written about people like him.
Oh, it was a bold statement. I'm glad he was able to pull it out. And, you know, the thing that I admired about it is that, you know, he's the one that, you know, he did everything that he had to do to win. You know, scored 3 goals and assists on one.
There's a new religion in town. Some people think the Messiah has come. Others think the Messiah is coming. But we know the Messiah is here, leading us to the promised land.
Mark, as you think back to Game 6 and what went into that victory, was there a need for you to stand up and take control of the team going into that game?
Well, Sam, I think one of the things that we really did well all year was at some point early in the year, we seemed to really instill a lot of confidence in our team. And we basically played first place from October to the end of the season in first place. And one of the reasons we were able to do that is because we were a very confident team. And through the playoffs, when fatigue becomes a factor and you get tired and injured and you go on and the season gets long, sometimes your confidence can waver. And I really felt at that particular time, when New Jersey was playing as well as they were, and they were putting up a tremendous fight against us, that our confidence started to waver. And there always seems to be a point in every playoff series or every playoff year that it becomes a point where you say to yourself, "Have we had enough? Is this as far as we can go? Can we win?" And I really felt that we were good enough to win the Stanley Cup, and I was positive we were good enough to win the series against Jersey. And I just basically really wanted to. My teammates to know that I really felt that, and for no other reason did I say that we were able to go where we were capable of going into New Jersey and winning the 6th game.
A Garden Game 7 for the right to play for the Stanley Cup. The early hero, Ryan Leach again, with one of the great goals in Stanley Cup history. In the second period, the Rangers led 1-0. The Garden was joyous, but guarded, because any attempt to build on that lead was thwarted. The tension grew to an enormous level and an amazing last-second end.
Back behind the net, driven around by Bukaboom. Driver blocks it. Larmer is on him. Richet centers. Stopped by Richter. The Devils score! They have tied it! The Devils have tied it with 7.7 seconds to go.
Overtime and dealing with the curse.
Here's a 2-on-1 for the Devils. McKay and Holik. McKay for Holik. And it's chipped out and saved by Richter.
Alvalin's got it.
McTavish knocked it down. Noonan shoots. Save. Where's the rebound? Brodeur's got it. Kovalov toward the net. Save. Rebound. Save Brodeur.
Across the line. Bruce Driver. Pass back. Richet shoots. Save. Richter. Rebound.
Where's the puck? It's in the corner. Noonan's got it.
Matisoff for the Devils plays it cross ice into the far corner. Matteau swoops in to intercept. Matteau behind the net. Swings it in front. He scores. Matteau. Defend Matteau. And the Rangers have one more hill to climb, baby. But it's Mark Vancouver. The Rangers are headed to the final.
Hit leadership and my Lanta. A Wales Conference trophy, a trip to the finals, and a new New York hero.
My little nephew at the beginning of the year told me that I was going to be traded to New York. I never believed him. But when the trade that happened, I gave him a call. He's like 8 years old, and it's the best feeling, you know, when they trade me to New York and you have had a chance to win the Stanley Cup, and now it's so close.
Lord Stanley's Cup, the most unique trophy in all of sports. Finally, it was in New York to be seen and to be had. The Rangers for the first time since 79 versus the Vancouver Canucks. Engraved on the chalice were 2 years that for both cities were much too long ago. Springtime was becoming summertime in New York, and some fans took time off for patient behavior.
We're going to school today? Hey? No school today?
Oh, we got out of it for this.
Did you? We were kids. We used to go to school 7 days a week.
The Canucks came to town with a come-from-behind survivor's trademark. Feisty coach Pat Quinn also had some baggage to carry into the series. Bad blood in New York's only visit during the regular season to the Pacific Northwest. The Canucks' big star is Pavel Bure, who scored the Game 7 overtime winner to beat Calgary, one of four times they've won in overtime. And so, it began, even though we couldn't hear a thing amidst the laser beams and dreams. Paying unprecedented dollars for a hockey ticket, fans at the game saw the Rangers get off to a quick start. Leach to Kovalov and a Steve Larmer rebound. However, Kirk McLean, who had never beaten the Rangers in his career, assumed the role of Ken Dryden, the hot goalie who says, "Climb on, boys, I'll carry you."
Lume stopped at the line by Messier, who breaks down on Kirk McLean. Messier in the net, save McLean, rebound cleared away from Adam Graves by McLean.
And remember that save, actually two of them.
With McLean making 52 saves, continuing his playoff greatness, the Canucks were alive, and then they tied the game when Brett Hedekin beat Mike Richter in the third. But the Rangers came back with a rush started by Brian Leetch, of course. They had a 2-1 lead, but there was a new last-minute hex developing. There was under a minute to play.
A missile on the board. Centers for Ronning, hopped over his stick. Ronning turns and shoots. Save. Richter, he's got it. Goal! Scored!
It's a goal.
It went in.
We're tied at two.
I thought he had it.
Carol Alt was one of those who said, okay, we're going to overtime again.
Tinkinen comes out in front. He shoots. Save. McLean. Rebound. Another save. Larmer leaves it for Tinkinen for the shot. Save. Rebound. A save, rebound, another save! McLean will not allow that puck to get by him!
Canucks win this, it'll be like Jesse James was in town. The Rangers have totally dominated. McLean has been sensational.
Tinkinen waiting to make a play. Finds Leach. Leach shoots, hit the post! He hit the post! Bure with a steal! Bure with a lead for Ronning. Ronning's got Adams. Adams shoots, scores! Vancouver wins!
Sometimes you wonder where justice is, but I will say justice is in a good performance by our goaltender. He gave us an opportunity to win a hockey game that perhaps we shouldn't have.
The best thing is to get opportunities and to put it at the net, and eventually, you know, you hope you get a rebound and maybe a fluke goal, because when he's playing that hot, you know, they're not always pretty, so you just keep throwing it at the net.
Most definitely we have to come up with a better effort, or we can't expect to win games like that for the rest of the series.
All right, guys. See you later.
For Game 2, the Rangers tested their depth by inserting a 10-year Canuck veteran, Doug Lidstrom, who for much of the season was one of the Black Aces, hadn't played in weeks, on the outs. Suddenly, there he was, a playoff star in the Stanley Cup Finals. Lidstrom's goal gave the Rangers a 1-0 lead, but it was becoming clear Vancouver was in the finals for a reason. Sergio Momesso tied the game 8 minutes later. After that, all they heard was a beautiful sound to Mike Richter's ears. Meanwhile, the Rangers were trying everything to beat Kirk McLean. Charging the net led to success when Messier found Glenn Anderson trailing the play. Just the way it used to work years ago in Edmonton. To preserve the 2-1 lead that they had, the Rangers set their sights on slowing down the Russian Rocket. Then they had to wait until the usual panic set in before they knew it was a job well done.
20 seconds to go. Jeff Brown across ice. Greg Adams moves in. Down the boards, Brown. Brown looking to center in front. And the shot deflected wide.
Richter
clears the zone. It's heading for the empty net. The Rangers will win.
Out of the Eastern time zone for the first time in 2 months, the Rangers land in the middle of a Canuck frenzy and in Vancouver, where Lord Stanley overlooks the city. It was easy to feel out of place. Sergei Zubov went west with a bad shoulder. For New York, that meant overcoming yet another thing. For him, it meant watching Game 3 and a series that was getting very serious. Again, the object of much Ranger aggression is Pavel Bure. But as was said before, this was a strategy to slow him, because there is very little you can do to stop him. Game 3 was a minute old.
Finds Bure on a breakaway! Scores! Kept in by Leach. A bouncer goes in! It went in off the stick of Kirk McLean! And the Rangers have tied it 1-1!
In the final minutes of the first period, the game took a dramatic turn when Bure, frustrated by the abuse he was taking, tried to give some back, but he did so with a high stick to Jay Wells' face, drew blood, and received a game misconduct.
Bure scored the goal that Vancouver has. He drew two penalties here in the first period, and he was doing everything. He was playing the point on the power play. He was double shifted, and now the Vancouver Canucks have to find a way for other people to come out and be heroes now.
No such Canuck ever appeared. 1 minute after that, the Rangers scored to take the lead and start an avalanche.
Kings are at full strength. Keegan is with a shot. Save a quick. Rebound score! Brian Leach! And the Rangers have a two-goal lead!
Oh, could you see this coming?
Rangers with Leach and Bukovo, Messier, Graves, and Larmer. Yes, and they score! Here's a chance for Kovalov. He scores! Alexei Kovalov! It's a power play goal!
Oh, I didn't want to hit him with my stick in the face. I never going to do this on a purpose. And it's an accident, this happens. But it won't change my style of the hockey.
A smiling face returned to the Ranger locker room in the locker of Alexei Kovalov. On a normal day, no big deal. But this was the finals, when every little sign is a superstitious one.
What is that, JD?
That's just a troll, a good luck troll. And that belongs to Alexei Kovalov. And after the New Jersey Devils series, after the last game, Game 7, somebody stole it and then returned it with a note. So here it is. And Kovalov's had it all through the playoffs, and obviously it's worked for him. Oh, thank God they got it back.
The construction crew building the Canucks' new home shows support. Well, not the whole crew.
Let's go, Rangers, let's go!
On a rainy day and on the beautiful Pacific Coliseum ice, the Rangers and Canucks met in Game 4. The home team took a 2-0 lead with Pavel Bure flying through the first period. Mike Richter discovered one save was not enough. Cliff Ronning's goal told the Ranger defense something had to change. Brian Leach decided words were not enough. So 4 minutes into the second period, he injected his team with much-needed life to make it 2-1. Mike Richter then did his amazing best.
By Ronning, he cuts in. Ronning shoots, saved by Richter. Good save by Richter coming out. Lume with a puck. He cuts in. Saved by Richter. Another save by Richter. Another save by Richter. And he made another one. Five saves by Mike Richter.
Later, Leach took down Pavel Bure as he was breaking free. The call was to award Bure a penalty shot. The emotional swing that a goal or save could create made it one of the series' most memorable moments. It was a time to concentrate for sure. And in his memory banks, Mike Richter recalled something. That fleeting moment of an all-star blur when the Russian Rocket had a breakaway and made his move. 4 months later, he gambled he would make the same one.
Everyone on their feet at Pacific Coliseum. Here comes Bure against Mike Richter. Saved by Richter! What a save by Mike Richter to stop Pavel Bure! They're going wild at the Garden.
anyone who doesn't believe in momentum didn't see Game 4, because before the second period was over, the game was tied. The cheers were gone in Vancouver, but the game remained tied until there were only 5.5 minutes to go, when Martin Jelena was called for roughing.
Coming down to 5 minutes to go, third period, 2-2 the score. Ryan Leach moves in around Glenn. He turns, he fakes, come on, score! A power play goal! Alexei Kovalov gives the Rangers a 3-2 lead. They're going wild at Madison Square Garden, and the Rangers have the lead for the first time in the game. Larmer looking, shoots in, off a skate, it goes in! It went in off Babich! The Rangers score and lead 4-2!
Oh my! The puck was going to go wide. It went off of Dave Babich, and celebrate, folks.
The Rangers led 3-1. But as they walked off, you just know what they were thinking about.
I knew that I wanted to come out as quick as I could to take most of his options away. And I knew this, that he'd come in with speed. You know, I mean, he's a fast, fast player. And he can, you know, change pretty quick. And I did the same thing on his breakaway goal the other night, the first game here, and but he found an opening, and this time he didn't.
Where the boys are playing, we'll bring it home. We don't want to make that trip back out here again. It's too far.
Back in New York, there was talk of a parade and plans for security at the celebration. Let's just say the city was optimistic. For the first time in history, the Stanley Cup was escorted to the Garden for the Rangers to win it. There was an escort, too, for the Canucks, who read the papers. The anticipation created a level of noise that caused the fifth floor of the Garden to bounce, and it even got louder when it appeared Esa Tiikkanen had given his team the lead. But a whistle blew. Offsides. No goal.
Three Rangers near the blue line. There's the puck. There's the puck. There's the puck.
That is not offside.
You're right. The puck's still on the line. The
linesman blew the call. That should have been a Ranger goal.
It got worse when, on the continuation of that same play, Sergio Momesso met with Brian Leach. Resulting penalties to Jeff Bukaboom for retaliating took him out of the game. The events uplifted Vancouver. They scored 26 seconds into the third period and went up 3-0 2 minutes later. It was agony for those familiar with that emotion. But then, for 6 glorious minutes, the game answered the anticipation, buoyed by a Doug Lidstrom goal that started something for the Rangers.
Looking toward the net, it hit a stick, the rebound, score! Steve Larmer! The crowd is into it now. Anderson, beautiful feed to Messier. Messier shoots, score!
Oh, baby!
The game is tied!
Boy, Vancouver refuses to use their timeout. The Rangers are rolling.
Put out in front, knocked away from Kovalov. Bore brings it out. Bore against Leach. Pass across, shot by Babich, he scores!
Oh, man.
The Canucks get it right back!
Right back and in 29 seconds. And then the Rangers completely fell apart in front of Mike Richter. The Canucks crashed the party 6-3.
We just have to regroup, get some, you know, get some rest, re-energize, and get ready to go in Vancouver. And we know we can win in there. We've already won 2 games, and we're looking forward to, you know, another challenge.
In a somber mood, the Rangers left New York. Meanwhile, Pat Quinn's team was treated as if they'd landed on the moon, and it was very far. But Murph was there anyway. A hyperbaric oxygen chamber, the only one in the NHL and in the Canucks' dressing room. It was receiving a lot of credit for the team's success. It decreased in many cases the impact of injury, as we heard from Irke Lume.
Well, it was great.
You feel better?
Oh, 100%. Feel fresh.
It certainly looked as though the Canucks were recharged by something. And the Rangers felt the impact of their energy in Game 6. 9 minutes into the first period, Jeff Brown scored the first of his 2 goals. And in the second period, Jeff Cortnall kept it going. The 4-1 win left the Rangers and their fans watching back in New York with a big headache. Did anyone say 1940? And there was another scenario threatening to undermine the team. Rumors had surfaced about Mike Keenan's postseason departure to Detroit. Editorially, the timing of this was not well received. He denied it at every opportunity.
I am not going to Detroit. I'm the coach of the New York Rangers. I signed a 5-year contract when I came here. There's no escape clause. I'm not looking for an escape clause. I came here to coach the New York Rangers, and hopefully that meant for 5-year duration, if not more.
For the first time ever, a Game 7 for the Stanley Cup at Madison Square Garden. This time it would be awarded, and a Ranger fan delivered a prayer that it would be to them. More somber than for Game 5, most of the faithful return.
My brother has to watch the game in the bathroom tonight. He has to listen to it in the bathroom. He always does. Whenever he does it, they win.
I'm wearing my lucky tie. Ranger gonna win tonight. All the way!
I brought my long range of silver bullet from when I was 6 years old, which was 38 years ago, which means the Rangers are gonna win the Stanley Cup tonight.
I've been coming for 40 years, and this is the first time I'm here at 1:30 instead of 3. And I want that cup. I want that cup.
Let's go, Rangers!
I want that cup.
Some fans reportedly paid thousands for their tickets. Still others had given up to do something else, like visit Dave and get picked from the audience so that Letterman could call Matt Loughran's team operations office for tickets. But Matt had bad news.
If you can't get me the tickets, just say so right now. Be a man, Matt.
Absolutely not.
Absolutely not? You can't get the tickets?
I have absolutely no tickets to give you.
All right, so you did. You kind of misled me there for a minute, didn't you, Matt?
Well, I didn't want to make you feel bad.
Yeah. Well, you're way too late for that.
Suddenly, there was Marv Albert coming to the rescue from the wings to deliver 2 tickets and save Dave. On Long Island, fans saddled up for the rough ride. In Manhattan, they watched while the Gwertzmans, ticket holders for 50 years, were afraid to look. The biggest hockey game ever played in the city of New York was this Game 7. And the players played as if it meant everything. And then Brian Leetch proved that it did.
Messier slowed down by Bore, gets by him. Messier cuts in, still with a puck. Nice pass to Zubov. Zubov feeds Leetch. Leetch scores!
Here's Sergei Zubov, stick handling up to the Vancouver line. A lead for Kovalev, sets up Price, walks and shoots, he scores! It is a power play goal by Adam Graves. His first goal of this series. And the Rangers with a 2-0 lead on the Vancouver Canucks.
The pace of the game never let up, and Pavel Bure circled, swirled, raced, and pulled out all of his tricks. A few hearts were skipping beats, but the lead was safe. But remember, hold the celebration. 5 minutes into the second period, Trevor Linden, the huge Canuck captain, scored. It was a one-goal game until the other captain offered an appropriate response.
Zubov and Leetch, Noonan turns, puts it in front, missed by Graves. Noonan's backhander save, and they score! Messier! It's a power play goal!
A rare Ranger vintage was on ice. Unthinkable caps ready to be worn, as the best team in hockey headed towards a third period to prove it. A 2-goal lead seemed comfortable, but 5 minutes into the dream, Trevor Linden removed the comfort zone, and the Canucks began the barrage.
Courtnall in center. Lead for Nathan Lafayette, moving in on Zubov. He shoots, save Richter, and McTavish got to the rebound. Lowe is back. Jelena with Linden and Ronning. Pass to Ronning, now to Jelena. Hit the post, and it's cleared by Lowe. Zubov is there, the shot, save Richter. Courtnall center, save by Richter!
There were groans and gasps, and some couldn't look. Bert and Serena Gwertzman couldn't take it.
We won the cup! We won the cup! We won the cup!
Corner it goes. Courtnall hits Zubov for the pass. Zubov swings it around. Weimer clears the zone. That's it! 54 years of curses are over! No more 1940!
Yes!
The New York Rangers are going to win!
There's 1.1
seconds
on the clock.
1.1.
I'd like to see
hold the celebration one more time.
Oh!
stop the clock with 1 second.
1.1?
No way.
Here it is. The waiting is over. The New York Rangers are the Stanley Cup champions. And this one will last a lifetime.
No more purses. This is unbelievable. These people have waited a long time. Fans, players, coaches. Unbelievable.
Let the celebration begin.
1940.
Player in the Stanley Cup playoffs is Brian Leetch.
Ladies and gentlemen,
hang on.
The Stanley Cup
Captain Mark Messier, come get the Stanley Cup.
They came from so many different places, and eventually they will go their separate ways. But for 10 months, the 1994 New York Rangers united for this very moment. For every time there was to believe it would happen, there was another to doubt its possibility. Except for them, they never gave in. We should all have that feeling just once in our lives.
There was a lady that was a very, very big Ranger fan that unfortunately passed away about 6 weeks ago. Her name was Cecile Seidel, and I think a lot of people read about that. It was an unfortunate situation in which she passed away, and I think, who knows, maybe she was the one that grabbed the ghost up in the rafters and kicked it right out of MSG. But whatever the case, bottom line is that, excuse me, Ranger fans, and people of New York will never, ever, ever have to hear 1940 ever again. Thank you.
Final thought to put a sentence, a capper on this evening's, JD?
Well, you know, Al, the season started with a plane trip to London, England, where the Rangers played very well under Mike Keenan to beat Toronto in two games. And then I had a chance to be with the Rangers, and I was here for the All-Star game, and a New York Ranger, Mike Richter, won the MVP. Then I had a chance to go to Lillehammer and see one of the classic games you'll ever see. Then I had a chance to do this, and this is better than it all. Combined, this is better than it all.
Sam, you called every goal. Give me one more sentence.
Messier, a hero. Leetch, Richter, Keenan, Neil Smith. Just wonderful. What a wonderful night and a wonderful season they gave us. A season to remember.
And it's about to happen again on a TV set right in front of you.